There are two different kinds of properties in QML. First, we have our standard properties like height and width, and some types are going to have their own additional properties, such as the text item has a text property. Some of the properties are going to be known be what are called group properties. An example of that is the font for our text object. The font has its own properties like family and point size, and these tell the text what font family to use or what point size. The preferred syntax for setting a group is shown on the left side, where we open the group and then we set each property. However, we can also do it where we set them individually. We need to fully qualify the name. So in our example here, we use font.family to set the font family and font.pointSize to set the point size. This method is really useful if you're only setting one of the objects or if you're trying to get a value from a group property. In addition to our standard properties, we also have properties that are known as attached properties. These properties are applied to QML objects. The key navigation property is an example of one kind of attached property. This allows us to work with key navigation like tab, back tab, up, down, etc. We can also define custom properties for any QML object. If we look on the right side, we have a rectangle. It has a custom property of mass that is of type real. The syntax to create a custom property is property type name colon bound or default value. After you create the property is now accessible like any standard property. If you want to access the property of a child in this manner, you have to use the special type alias. This can be seen with the circle button. The circle button's BG color is bound to item A's color property. Now, you guys have heard me use the term binding several times. Let me tell you what a binding is. A binding is like an assignment, but it has one small but significant difference. The binding is reevaluated every time the bound data changes. This means if we create a rectangle and its height and width are bound to its parent's height, at runtime, if the user resizes the window, the rectangle's parent's height is going to change, and this is going to cause the binding for width and height to be reevaluated. It's going to use the new value for height, and then it's going to update the size for our rectangle. The uses of binding goes way beyond setting geometries for an object, and it should be noted that if you have to pass a bound value to a JavaScript function, you should be sure to not break your binding by using an assignment operator. You can prevent this by making a call to cute.binding, and this will preserve your binding as shown with the last bullet here. One very useful property to set is ID. This allows us to get a reference to the object that we can use later, usually to access the object's properties. Now, we don't have to set an ID for every object. We only really need to set IDs for those objects that we want to access from a non-child or a non-child object. Once we set an ID for our object, our text object, the rectangle can now use its ID to access its properties. And then we can bind the rectangle's X, Y, and width to the title's X, Y, and width. When you choose IDs, you have to make sure to follow a couple rules. IDs may not begin with an uppercase letter, number, or symbol, and the ID may not be parent. Parent is a special, is a keyword that's used by objects to reference their parent. Here, we're setting the color for each one of these rectangles. We're able to set the color property in one of three different ways. We can use HTML color notation. This is done by making a string that starts with the pound symbol and then our HTML color. This is how we've set the color for our first rectangle to red. We can use an SVG named color like we do for our blue rectangle. And we can also use the third option, which is a call to qrgba, where we provide a red, green, blue, and alpha value between 0 and 1.0. This is exceptionally useful if you want to have some color opacity. All items in QML also have an opacity value, opacity property, excuse me, that takes a value between 0 and 1.0. And this will let us to find how opaque the item is. The QML type image allows us to load an image. This image can be a PNG, bitmap, GIF, or JPEG. Images have a source property. This is used to set the source of the image to a URL. The URL can either be relative or absolute. The images can be scaled or rotated along the center or any other axis. And by default, the height and width of an image is going to be set to the source file's height and width. We also have a text item. This is an item that's used to display text. It's read-only text. It has a property font that is of the font type. This controls how or what font and font styling is used to render the text. It also has a text property. The text can either be a simple string or HTML. One thing that we have to often consider when we use the text item is what size the text itself should be. We have a couple options. We can use the font point or pixel size to set a point or pixel size. We can additionally set a font size mode to tell it how it should adjust. And we can also use the painted width and painted height to determine the rendered height and width of the text once it's on screen.
Thanks for watching. If you want to learn more, please subscribe to our channel and check out the free QML programming course on our website. The link is in the description.